Once again, we are very grateful for the privilege we have to still come together, even though virtually, at great distances from one another, and yet connected in this way, to continue to worship our God, to continue to glorify the Lord Jesus as a people of God here in KMC. From Corinth to Colombo, the journey has been an enlightening and challenging one for me. I have been enlightened by the insights and increased understanding that I have gained about Paul's letter to the Corinthians as I have prepared to do some of the teaching at this series of services. And of course, through the rich insights that have been shared by Reverend Ebi and by Sanjayan through their reflections in the past few weeks. But it has also been a challenging one for me, because I have been confronted again by the high demands of our calling to live for Jesus Christ in the 21st century. I have seen my own shortcomings and considered some of the needs of our own fellowship here at KMC. In the light of what the Apostle Paul has been explaining to the Corinthian Christians to be the norm for the Christian church. As has been said before, 1 Corinthians is written as a response by Paul to two sets of issues. The first set of issues comes to him from people from Chloe's household. You would have seen that in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and 11. They had come to visit him and they had shared with him some of the problems that were going on in the Corinthian church. Quarrels and disputes, litigation against fellow Christians, and the endorsement of even blatant immorality like incest and the soliciting of prostitutes. Unthinkable, but Chloe's household members had come and shared those with Paul in person. But we also know that in the Corinthian letter, Paul is responding to another set of issues that have been brought to him in the form of a letter. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 17, we are told that three men, Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus, had brought a letter from the Corinthians where they have listed a number of issues that they would like Paul to comment on. Issues to do with marital relations, food associated with idolatry, and how to understand Christian spirituality, for instance. So Paul first deals with the issues that Chloe's household members had brought to him in chapter 1 through chapter 6, and then from chapter 7, he sets about responding to the issues from the letter. So when we think about Paul's letter to the Corinthians, I think that the underlying problem is a clash of worldviews. As we look more deeply at this letter, we find that there are tensions between the Corinthians, between them, but also between a majority of them and Paul. And these tensions have arisen because of a clash of worldviews. Paul is a Christian apostle, and so, along with people like Timothy and Sosthenes, and perhaps a few of the Christians, Paul's worldview was at odds with the worldview that prevailed above on the hearts and minds of the majority of the Corinthian Christians. Now, what is a worldview? Some people would say a worldview is what you see, but actually a worldview is not what you see. A worldview is what you see with. It is the glasses with which we look at the world. And so Paul's worldview was very different to the worldview of many of the Corinthians. Now, of course, they were baptized believers. They had been converted from their previous beliefs, from trusting in idols for their salvation or trusting in the Jewish law for their salvation. They had definitely made the radical decision to completely trust Jesus Christ as their Savior. But they had been converted in their identity and loyalties, but not converted in their worldview. They were still looking at life and still looking at values and decision-making through the lenses of their social and cultural upbringing. Now, is this possible? Can this happen to us? Most certainly, it can happen to you. It can happen to me. It can happen to every one of us. In fact, I think the single greatest challenge to our discipleship is that many Christians today are going through the Corinthian crisis. They are trying to live Christianly without having developed the ability to think Christianly. They are trying to live Christianly without developing the ability to think Christianly. They are trying to gain a Christian perspective on life without wearing the world while wearing the worldly pair of spectacles. Now, marriage matters forms the major concern raised by the Corinthians in the 7th chapter of the letter. In this chapter, there are actually two questions that Paul is faced with. The Corinthians first ask it in chapter 7 and verse 1, and that was whether a good Christian is someone who must completely reject sexual contacts as fundamentally unspiritual in itself, and therefore even distance oneself from one's own spouse. They said, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. That was 7 and verse 1. But when it comes to chapter 7 and verse 25, 26, there is a second question. The second question has to do with the increasing number of unmarried young women or the virgins in the church. Because the men of marriageable age were rethinking their engagements and rethinking their betrothals, and others were glorifying the unmarried life as the most spiritual life. They were saying something like, it is good for a man to remain as he is, a bachelor, an unmarried person, because that is more spiritual. So both these queries come under the broader subject of marriage matters. And when I use that phrase, marriage matters, I'm reminded of a book written by Tania Ferdinandes, one of our own members. She's written this amazing book called Marriage Matters, which is a devotional for married couples. And I'm using this moment for a little spot to encourage you, if you're a married couple, to consider getting a copy of this book published by Back to the Bible, which can really be an encouragement and a blessing to you and your spouse as you share in devotions together. Last week, Sanjayan dealt with the first question in chapter 7 under the topic, A Christian Response to Social Pressure. And he helped us to see how Paul was reshaping the worldview of the Corinthian believers. In the midst of their specific challenges, Sanjayan was explaining to us that Paul was saying, the gospel does not call for our extraction from our social situations, but to reorient our existing relations and passions in a Christward direction. Let me say that again. The gospel does not call for our extraction from our social situations, but to reorient our existing relations and passions in a Christward direction. Now today we continue Paul's response to related concerns, and I have called our exploration of the message of chapter 7, verse 25 to 40, thinking Christianly about marriage matters. Now, the context of a letter of the New Testament is very important to understand a biblical passage there. We must remind ourselves again that when we are reading a letter like the letter to the first Corinthians, we are really listening to one end of a telephone conversation. It is almost like listening to someone talking on the phone. We don't know what the other person is saying. We only hear 50% of the conversation. So we've got to reconstruct what's going on the other side. An added complication is that we are listening to a conversation between two people, actually half a conversation, between two people who are living 2,000 years ago in a time so distant in another part of the planet. And how do we understand this conversation? How do we reconstruct what's going on? What were their norms? What were their cultural values? What were their behaviors? What did they mutually recognize? What were the pressing social and political challenges that were current at the time? What did people instinctively and immediately understand? I want to invite you to imagine with me that 500 years from now, someone has come across an extract of an ancient email that had been written by a pastor to his congregation in October 2020. And this is what it says. Now about what you wrote to me. In view of the present crisis, yes, it is best that husbands or wives or other immediate family members who have been abroad or in Gampaha should not return to their homes. Make sure that they are isolated and prevented from getting anywhere near their spouses, leave alone having any physical contact. And yes, tell them that even when you have in-person services, to please stay put and don't cite the church. Meanwhile, I have heard from some people that when you do have the regular services, there are a few of you who are waltzing in without washing hands, checking temperatures, and worse still, without wearing a face mask. Isn't it obvious that this is such an unacceptable behavior? Shouldn't someone be taking these matters up with these offenders before the church loses all credibility in the city? You will understand how the context helps every one of us to understand what's going on with all those instructions and all those particularities about masks and about social distance. So marriage matters in Corinth has an underlying worldview. In chapter 7 and verse 25 to 27, now about virgins, Paul says, I have no command from the Lord, but I give a judgment as the one who by the Lord's mercy is trustworthy. Because of the present crisis, I think it is good for a man to remain as he is. Are you pledged to a woman? Do not seek to be released. Are you free from such a commitment? Do not look for a wife. In Corinth, there are an increasing number of unmarried girls in the church. But more recently, there had been a pushback from marriage. People are saying it is good for a man to remain as he is. It seems that this is one of the quotations from their letter. Now, when you think about it in the Jewish biblical worldview, it was good to be married. In that worldview, marriage was the default. This was what every young man and young woman was expected to do. So where did this idea of abstinence or asceticism come from? A substantial number of the Corinthian Christians were not Jewish, they were Greek. And certainly the city in which they lived was one of the most world-renowned centers of Greek culture in the Roman Empire. Greek philosophy divided the world into the spiritual and the material, the good stuff and the bad stuff. The spiritual, the intellectual, the religious was essentially moral. It was good, it was honorable, it was superior. But the physical, the material, the sensual, and the pleasurable was by its very nature inferior and shameful and bad and immoral. So naturally, marriage with its physical and very social dimensions was best avoided, or so they thought. Like the Corinthians, we too live in a culture where this is the basic worldview. Indian religious thought that gave rise to both Hinduism and Buddhist philosophy essentially divides the world into that intangible spiritual or intellectual realm versus the material and sensual realm. The former is considered good, but the latter is mere illusion. It is mere craving. It is an imprisonment for the soul. It is the physical matters like marriage and relationships that actually block your path to salvation in that way of thinking. But Paul shows us in this short chapter how thinking Christianly about marriage actually matters. So how does Paul go about responding to the concerns? Surprisingly, he actually agrees with the Corinthians' suggestion. It is good for a man to remain as he is. But he does so for completely different reasons. Paul is absolutely clear that marriage is not to be thought of as unspiritual or sinful or an inferior act. No way, he says. In 7:28, he says, if you do marry, you have not sinned. And if a virgin marries, she has not sinned. So Paul's reasons for endorsing the single life are very different. He begins by explaining that it is better because of the present crisis, he says, in chapter 7 and verse 26. What was this crisis? We can't be sure, but it is likely that a worldwide famine was affecting Corinth as well with severe food shortages and malnourishment. In Acts 11:28, Agabus the prophet actually predicted that a severe famine would sweep over the entire Roman world. And the Bible says, and this happened during the period or the reign of Claudius, which was just about 3 or 4 years before Paul wrote his letter. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 30, Paul says about the Corinthian church something very odd. He says, many of you are weak, and a number of you have fallen asleep or died. This is an unusual thing to say about a community. Many of you are weak, and a number of you have died. So Paul's advice seems to be tailored to this particular context of a health crisis in Corinth. But he also says that he knows that those who marry will face many troubles in this life. And I want to spare you this, verse 28. He is aware of the burdens that come upon people who get married in this crisis time. And he is pastorally concerned about their ability to manage. You know, he's like a parent who is genuinely concerned for the children's welfare. Thirdly, he knows that marriage demands a division of interests. And really, marriage is the more challenging status in life than singleness when it comes to following the radical demands of Jesus Christ. In verse 32 to 35, Paul speaks about the challenge of having divided interests, of having to manage and balance all these priorities. The sincere Christian who chooses to marry has to take care of his or her spouse and family without compromising the commitment to radical discipleship. And this is by far the tougher choice. So he concludes that the person who marries the virgin does right, but he who does not marry her does better. He is clearly pointing Christians to think in counterintuitive terms about marriage and singleness. So as we think about this short ending to chapter 7, what is our takeaway about Paul as he thinks Christianly about marriage matters? I have two things that I would like to suggest to you as our takeaway. The first is, consider a lifetime of singleness as a valid option, number one, if you are unmarried. Consider a lifetime of singleness as a valid option, number one, if you are unmarried. Today, like in the first century, the status of singleness is socially challenging. People tend to think that something must be wrong with someone who hasn't got married beyond a certain age. Everyone and her second cousin are out to get you hitched or matched and cannot stop talking about it with such sympathetic tones. Then, of course, there is the additional challenge that in our very nuclear family age, if you are single, you are more likely to struggle with being excluded from families and communities that are geared to nuclear family-oriented activities. And yet, Paul is holding out that singleness is the better option. Singleness, of course, can be due to circumstances, but it also can be due to choice. No matter the reason for it, Paul suggests that it is the better option, but only if we view it Christianly, only if the Christian takes singleness on with a Christian mind. So if singleness is your circumstance in life, Paul wants you to remember the sovereignty of God over your status in life. In chapter 7 and verse 17 to 24, three times Paul says, each person should live as a believer in whatever situation the Lord has assigned to them. It is a difficult reality for so many today that marriage has not become possible, even though that would be their preferred choice. God's word encourages you to remember the sovereignty of God within that experience of disappointment and even disadvantage. But he also says to the single person to recognize and affirm publicly that singleness opens up the greatest freedom to be concerned about the Lord's affairs. You know, I must say I haven't heard very many single Christian people affirm this truth publicly, that it provides the greatest freedom to be concerned about the Lord's affairs, as Paul says in verse 32 and 34. And I can think of one person that I have spoken with who has been refreshingly forthright about it. Someone who grew up in our own church, went into Christian ministry, and then chose singleness as a choice, as a decision for life. But when I spoke with that person, to find that that joy, that contentment, and that public affirmation that this is the right place for me. This is how I am able to serve God best, and I am content with my situation in life. And as Minoli and the team led us earlier with that song, Christ is Enough for Me. I'm thinking also of a song by Kenny Marks written many years ago, where he talks about a single-minded love. And the chorus says, give me single-minded love that will make my life complete. I don't want to worry anymore about the one that I might meet. Lord, I know you have a plan, though at times it's hard to see. But give me single-minded love as I give you all of me. And then Paul also tells the person who is choosing singleness or finds himself in that situation, make sure that it is settled in your own mind and settled in your own emotions. As he says, but the man who has settled the matter in his own mind, who is under no compulsion, but has control over his own will, and who has made up his mind not to marry the virgin, this man also does the right thing. Singleness, if it is by choice, cannot be Christian if it is for unbiblical reasons. Whether it is out of a misguided idea of spirituality, or whether it is merely for self-centered convenience of being able to say, you know, by being single, I am able to do what I like when I like it. That would not be the motive for singleness according to the scripture. Finally and secondly, Paul is teaching us to be Christianly intentional about the decision to marry. When a young person takes Christian discipleship so seriously as to consider a lifetime of singleness as his or her first option, and then decides that I'm going to marry, that decision to marry becomes increasingly intentional because it becomes a thought-through decision. And I want to challenge the young unmarried people among us to make sure your decision to marry is intentional. Because too many of us are programmed by our culture to default to marriage. After all, that's what you are supposed to do after school and after university and after finding your career. What do you do next? Obviously, you marry. So we've got this sort of programming that makes us default towards marriage. In addition, we are programmed by our culture to buy into the fairy tale endings of Disney movies. So they were married and lived happily ever after, ... the end. That storyline is delightfully fantastic, but neither realistic nor Christian, because no marriage is a guarantee of unbroken, unchanging feelings of bliss and happiness. In fact, it involves growth pains, frustrations, hard work, and even harder choices. It is certainly not for the person who binges on Disney movies or rom-coms. Paul says, those who marry will face many troubles. So neither is marriage forever after as the fairy tales end. Because marriage is temporal. It is not eternal. We say in our marriage service, till death us do part. It is the biggest commitment, certainly, that one will make to another human being ever, but it is also finite and bound to a time, and so must be treated as a sacred trust. So how can a believer show his or her Christian intentionality when choosing marriage? I want to just say four things that Paul points to us about choosing marriage. First, choose to marry knowing that this new status in life will significantly increase your troubles and increase your responsibilities. I know I'm kind of sounding sober, but this is a sobering thought. Something that marriage counselors often struggle to communicate to couples in those early years of their romantic relationship, because they are convinced that their passion for each other and their love will make all the hassles melt like butter in a frying pan. But secondly, choose to marry because you are committed to being other-centered and honorable in how you treat other people. Paul says in verse 36, if anyone is worried that he might not be acting honorably toward the virgin he is engaged to, and if his passions are too strong and he feels he ought to marry, he should do as he wants. He is not sinning, they should get married. You know, we say to young couples often, good people make good marriages. Here is a person who is looking at the one he's engaged to, and he wants to treat that girl honorably. He wants to treat his own decision in an honorable, other-centered way. But thirdly, he's saying, choose to marry because you are more concerned about safeguarding your sexual purity than experimenting with a lifestyle that you are not convinced about. Too many people go into singleness as a choice, thinking that they have it in them to be able to pull it off. But Paul says in verse 9, if they cannot control themselves, they should marry. For it is better to marry than to burn with passion. And finally, Paul says, choose to marry a Christian believer who is committed to live for Jesus. In verse 39, he says, a woman is bound to her husband as long as he lives. But if he dies, she is free to marry anyone she wishes. But he adds, but he must belong to the Lord. This, I believe, is the most explicit statement in the New Testament about how a Christian can make a choice about a marriage partner. On the one side, Paul says she is free to marry anyone she wishes. There is such freedom in the choice. But on the other, he says, but he must belong to the Lord. There is an exclusive limitation about the person that you should be considering, because it is a choice, and it doesn't happen because you fell in love. It happens because you chose that person as your lifelong partner in the Lord. And so we bring our thoughts then to a conclusion by committing ourselves to the Lord in prayer as we think Christianly about marriage matters. Let us pray. Our gracious Father, we thank you for your word, the wisdom of your word, the instructions of your word, and the way you speak to us in our particular situations. We also thank you for the reminder that your word is not easy. It is not always comforting. Sometimes it disturbs us and challenges us. We have to think anew. We have to change. We have to transform our way of being so that we may look with your spectacles, your worldview, at life and the world and the future. We pray for those among us who are making decisions at this very moment about how they will think about marriage. Oh Lord, we pray for your grace and your Holy Spirit's guidance. We ask that you will help us to be gracious with one another and help us to be faithful in your presence, especially in these matters of marriage. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.